Welcome, my disciples, to a new episode of Mere Chance. Today, we finally reached a point where the story, where the journey towards the truth begins. Before I begin, I will make a little recap. I will try to be as succinct as possible. Because yes, a little recap just about, you know, how consent works or what consent is. And then we'll finally get to the story. If you're wondering if we'll find out soon what's in the second world, the answer is no. Because this is chapter 4. I'm gonna sum up chapter 4 and chapter 5 today, and the characters will leave the first world at chapter 19. So actually, as a no, okay, yes, they leave at chapter 19, but I think it takes them still 2 chapters. I don't remember because they when they leave, then they still have to cross the bridge, and that takes its own time as well. I think it takes 1 or 2 chapters. I think they might be included in those 19s. And then from chapter from chapter 20, I think we will actually see the second world. And I found out with great disappointment that the chapters weren't as many as I thought they were. But anyway, but it's gonna be there's still lots of materials. There's still lots of materials, so don't worry about that. I don't think you were worried at all, but just in case. I'll just begin, because as always I start blabbering about. Okay, so a little recap. Mere Chance is a psychological fantasy revolving around a mental connection that happens between people. This mental connection is called consent system, and once people get connected through the consent system, they become consent, which means they have to leave the first world, place they live in, and go to the second world, a place that nobody knows what's in it, and the people that have ventured inside it never came back. The main characters are Marika. She's an assassin, and she does some strange business as well, revolving around cancer. Then we have Kirian. He's a rich and spoiled socks designer, and as I said, I think he is unconsciously leading a cult. And then we have Manhattan. I have nothing to say about Manhattan. He's just fucking boring. But he's just he's supposed to be a normal kid. I have my doubts about that. But anyway, okay. This was it. So now we're still in the first world. The characters have just experienced the connection, and from now we will they will, you know, try to find each other. But the task of finding the other two is up to Manhattan, because it's the only one that has the names. In these 2 chapters, nothing much happens really. It's just foreshadowing and some more foreshadowing and some questionable content. Anyway, the chapter begins with Marika and Dorian at one of their flats. I don't know who is in it, doesn't matter. And Marika says, "Oh, I'm sorry, I kept saying Lou, 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 and I didn't even think about you or my family." and Terence reassures her, saying that it's okay, and that, you know, if he could, he would definitely go with her, but he can't. And then Marika thinks, I guess some things cannot be avoided, or can they? What if Dorian asked me about this sooner? Now we would probably be living together, and maybe, at the time, I would have been thinking about something else rather than Lou. Because yes, in a previous chapter, Dorian asked Marika to go live together. Even though I fail to see how that is relevant to how to the events that led up to the connection. Because Marika just, the connection happened with Marika wondering whether Lou could see the stars from the second world, and with her giving the gun to Dorian. So the living together thing wasn't at the center of the discussion at the time. So I don't understand. Anyway, and then she continues, maybe this connection would have never happened. The possibilities are endless. And then they talk about, no, they don't talk about them, but they mention that they want to go through, no, Marika read some of the documents they stole from the researchers they killed last week or whatever, documents about cancer, and she asked Dorian if he read them, and he said no, and she says, then look at this, like, look what I found, and we don't know yet what she found, and to be honest, I don't remember what she finds. I mean, in this chapter, in the next one, it won't be mentioned. I hope it will be at some point. But who knows? Only time will tell. Then with the scene switches to Manhattan, because from now on, the chapters are a bit of a mix of points of view. Because they happen all at the same time. So now we visit Manhattan and his friends, Delilah and Nova. They were camping when the connection happened, and now they're going home. They don't want to stay out camping anymore. Manhattan reacts strangely because he doesn't seem very shaken up by the situation, by the connection. And I think it's related to cancer that, I don't know, it kind of numbs your feelings of despair or something. I don't know. Because Delilah and Nova are really shaken up by the situation. They're like, what the fuck, our friend Manhattan has to leave, we don't want that to happen. Manhattan, are you okay? They're very worried about him because he seems way too normal. And guys, I'm with you, like, Manhattan, are you okay? And they're going home, and Manhattan says, do you guys want to stay at my place? I think I might actually need someone next to me right now. But then he thinks, that's a lie, but I don't want them to go and worry about me. I don't want them to feel bad because of me. So, I don't know, Manhattan is showing some, I don't know, he's strange. At first I thought he was like some sort of psychopath, because it's like, no emotions transpire from his point of view. But then he worries about his friends. So, I don't know, I don't get it. If he were a psychopath, that would be the only interesting thing about him. But anyway, let's go ahead. Then there's just, there's so much filler. No, okay, I mean, there are just a lot of dialogues that help us understand how Manhattan is supposed to feel scared about this thing, but how he doesn't. So it's just them being worried about Manhattan. And then Manhattan wonders, okay, now I got the names and all, but how do I find them? And then the chapter ends with Marika waking up at night, and she calls, I don't know why I said waking up at night, because it's not night, it's early morning. Anyway, she gets up from bed, and she goes call her mom, and she tells her that she will swing by sometime the week after, because she has to tell them, to tell her and Justina, her sister, something important. And obviously it's that, you know, she's leaving. And then, well, Marika thinks, is wanting to leave cruel? I just wish to find Lou and live with her in a world where we can both be happy, like when we were young. I miss you, and I'll find you soon, Lou. I'm happy. And at this point, I thought, I like Marika's take on the situation, because obviously she has Lou is in the second world, but she doesn't know whether she's just alive, she's dead, whether she'll ever find her, whether she herself will be alive once she stepped once she steps in the second world. I find it interesting, this wanting to leave, because we have rather distinctive reactions to this, because obviously Marika, she's on one side, she's sad that she has to leave, because for example there's Dorian, there's Justina, there's her mom that she's leaving behind, but at the same time she's gonna, there are chances, there is still a single hope that she will find Lou in a second world, so she's holding on to that. So she, on one hand, she's very curious about it, she really wants to go. Then we have, we'll find out in a second, Kirian, that absolutely doesn't want to go, like he would do anything not to go. And then we have Manhattan is, I don't get him, I don't get Manhattan, he's very mild, he's mild about everything. He doesn't really have a personality, I'm very sorry about that. Manhattan, you have no personality. I think I tried very hard to make him likable, but it just fucking isn't, because he's not, I don't know. A Shurak would have more personality than him. And then the second thing about Marika is, I wondered, is she in love with Lou? I mean, obviously you can be very friendly with someone so much that you think like Marika does, but I also wondered, is Marika in love with Lou? Because I don't remember. I think one of the two was in love with the other or something. Or maybe I discarded the idea. I don't remember, to be honest, but I'm wondering. I will leave that question lingering in the air. Then we get to the next chapter. Yes, that was all that was happening in that chapter. But also this one is not really filled with all that much information. As I said, it's filled, there's some foreshadowing here and there. So the next chapter begins with Kirian and Julian waking up the day after, and Kirian says he's super drunk, he doesn't remember anything from the night before. And Julian looks at him in a strange way, like he keeps on staring at him, because Julian does know. He understood what happened with Kirian the night before. He understood that the connection happened, but he doesn't know how to approach the subject with Kirian, because Kirian seemingly doesn't remember. And Kirian says, Julian, if something extremely embarrassing happened to me, then keep it to yourself. I'm not in the mood to listen to it. And then adds, but if something extremely embarrassing happened to you, then I want to know right now. And then Kirian goes to the bathroom to take a shower. And at that point, he remembers what happened the night before, and he remembers the connection. And he goes back to the bedroom, and Julian says, I know, he confesses he knows what happens to Kirian the night before, and that he knows that Kirian realized it just now. But Kirian doesn't want to talk about it. He says, I don't want to talk about it now, let's talk about it tomorrow. And Kirian thinks that he doesn't want to go. He says, I don't want to go, I don't want to leave, I don't want to be separated by all this, I can't believe it's me. And then he says, I would rather die. So there's some foreshadowing going on here. And then Kirian goes to his office, and he meets my favorite character, Roger. I don't know, every time I read his name, I was like, yes. And Roger says something along the lines of, Kirian, you are our hero, our socks hero, or something. We love you, please never leave us. And Kirian thinks, well, that's some weird timing, why are you saying this? And Roger says that, you know, lately he seemed to be a bit down, and so he wanted to, you know, cheer him up. And Kirian, does something that Roger, and neither did I, expects. He says, thank you, Roger. And Roger is like, he says, how long has it been? 4 years? In 4 years, you never said thanks to me. I feel like I reached a new level of friendship with Kirian. I'm so happy. Thank you. I'm looking forward to tell my friends. He's such a cronk. Seriously. I so imagined him like a cronk. with the oven mittens on and just showing his what was he cooking? I don't remember. Then yeah, that was pretty much it. That pretty much it. For Gideon, who thinks should I fire him? No, actually, and then we're left with yet another question lingering in the air. And then the chapter ends with Manhattan going to Mrs. Coy, which I found out in this chapter, her first name is Hannah. So I'm happy to know Mrs. Coy has a first name. Manhattan was wondering how he's supposed to find these people, and so he realizes that the only person he can ask this to is Mrs. Coy. So he goes to Mrs. Coy. And she tells him how to find these people, which I remind you have to put your hand on one of the name or the name, close your eyes and kind of visualize the name in your head. And once you open your eyes again, you are in this white space. So Manhattan opens his eyes and he is in this, like, there's nothing, there's just whiteness around him. And it feels a bit light and soft and a bit numb, and he feels a bit numb as well. And he looks in front of himself and sees a blurry image of a person, and that is supposed to be Gideon. And then he tries with Marika as well, and he sees that Marika's image is clearer. So he figures out that he's gonna look for Marika first, because the clearer the image is in your head, the closer, geographically speaking, that person is to you. So it only makes sense that he would start with Marika. And then Mrs. Coy tells Manhattan there's this thing that is supposed to sound prophetic, but to be honest, it's not. Anyways, she says, "Remember when I told you about my aunt working at the bridge that connects the first and second world? Well, she never believed even once that the second world was a cursed place. On the contrary, if there is such a selection decided by fate, it must be quite a privilege to go there. Discovery, Manhattan, the unknown, is what's most fascinating and scary in the world. Whatever happens, there are bonds that cannot be broken and connection that were meant to be." I don't know, it sounds like Mrs. Coy knows a lot. Way too much. Way too much than she's supposed to. Whatever. Yes, this ends chapter 4 and chapter 5. I don't remember. I think it's gonna take one or two chapters more before Manhattan actually leaves to go and look for Marika and Kirian. I don't know to remember. I do not remember. I don't know, to be honest. I don't remember. We will find out soon, I guess. Oh, wow. Are you excited to know what's going to happen next? I am. I hope I'm not the only one. And I hope you're having fun and you are interested in the story. I so look forward to go on reading, because this is the part I remember the least, because I'm afraid it's going to be the most boring, but I'll try not to make it too boring for you. But let's see what the future has in store for us. Yeah, thank you for sticking around. I am having so much fun.